If you have a smart speaker, you have access to the entire world of NPR and St. Louis Public Radio. All the latest news and all the captivating stories. Activate our voices with yours by telling your smart speaker to play St. Louis Public Radio.
Since leaving office in early 2017, former Governor Jane Nixon has definitely kept himself busy. He's joined a law firm and argued some high-profile cases in front of appellate courts. But the Democratic official still has lots of thoughts about politics and policy in the Show-Me State. He joins us to talk about that and much more on the latest edition of Politically Speaking. So let's hit the music.
This is the Politically Speaking podcast, a candid conversation with the Show-Me State's biggest political newsmakers.
I'm Jason Rosenbaum.
And I'm Joe Manish.
Elections should be about your accomplishments. What have you done to qualify you for the position, and why are you qualified to run?
I'm going to push back on these regulators.
I'm doing this for the people.
I was encouraged along the way, not just by my family, but by a lot of teachers and professors, and knew when I was in college that I would run for office someday.
We're very excited about the prospect of having some more free market solutions.
Even though after the conversation, I still might not agree.
We want our listeners to get a real sense of what drives these people.
They're actually people with a story to tell.
And welcome to Politically Speaking. I'm your host, Jason Rosenbaum, a reporter with St. Louis Public Radio. Joining me in studio today is
colleague Joe Manis.
And our very, very special guest, the demon from DeSoto, the unicorn from University City, the 55th governor of the state of Missouri.
Thank you. It's great to be with you all, and it's also great not to be with you all the time.
Yeah, you may recognize that voice. That's Democrat Jay Nixon.
And we're really thrilled to have you back on the show. We're going to talk about a series of topics with you out of the governorship. Maybe you
about 18 months now, mm-hmm. right?
Yeah, I was just telling the governor when we were going up the elevator. It is kind of jarring to see you without security, just walking by yourself. You must just be having the time of your life.
It's liberating, and I can take care of myself. I don't feel threatened. But bottom line is, it's good. Georgiana and I are both happy to have made it, honored by the service, and enjoyed both the process as well as the responsibility. But we talk about it as our third 30. The first, we were 30 before we got married, 30 years of public service, and 30 years of something else.
Just amazing. So before we get into topics, just kind of explain to our listeners what you're doing now, because you have not been an inactive former governor. You've actually taken your law license that wasn't really dormant when you were in public service. You were attorney general, and you were still active when you were governor, and you're using it to the full effect.
Yes, I am. I mean, I enjoy practicing law, and just a few weeks ago argued at the state Supreme Court, also argued this year at the Eastern District and Western District Court of Appeals. I'm practicing law with Dowd Bennett. I'm also teaching at WashU Law School and having dinner every once in a while with Georgiana and others.
Can you mention, I mean, just in general, what those two cases were about, the big ones?
The big ones that I just argued?
Yes.
The biggest of them deals with a project called the Clean Line Energy, called the Grain Belt Express, a $2.3 billion project to bring wind energy from western Kansas to Indiana. All the other states had approved it. A case came down in the Western District that held back the PSC from granting the certificate that was necessary. We went to the Eastern District and won there. Then that case was transferred to the Supreme Court, and I then won that case in a unanimous ruling from the court just last week.
I don't usually reveal direct messages publicly, but Jack Cardetti, who was your former communications director, apparently was there when you were arguing, and he apparently told Georgianne that it looked like he left a little money on the table by being in public service these last 30 years, which was a compliment, basically saying your lawyering skills are pretty darn good. And it's I know this is kind of an insular question, but as a person who actually worked for a legal publication, when you go from, you know, being kind of a private practice attorney, which you were, I assume, before you were attorney general, to then like being in public service for almost 30 years, Is it hard to kind of revert back to that, or was it like a light switch and you were able to do it pretty easily?
Well, when I was Attorney General, I tried cases too, and I argued appellate case, argued twice myself at the U.S. Supreme Court. So appellate
is
something
at least one of them.
Yeah, I know. But you can get the time. Appellate, the issues are narrowed.
Yes.
And you can predict when the case is going to be and whatnot. So that was something as Attorney General I argued in the state Supreme Court a number of times and other courts too. So the appellate part was not hard. As governor, it's a lot different though. I used to say that litigation when you're a governor is just a slow legislative session. If you like it, you agree with it. If you don't like it, you call them back next year and fix it. You know what I mean? So it just seemed like any time there was a lawsuit, it slowed things up as to what I was trying to get done. So I will say I had to do a number of moot courts before my arguments, and I got better. I mean, you can't really – I mean, one of the early moot courts, one of the folks that was playing a judge asked a question, and I said, that's a really stupid question. And you're really not supposed to say that to judges.
No.
But, no, I spent a lot of time preparing and felt like I understood the issues, and I'm glad that folks think I'm doing a decent job at it.
What's the biggest difference? I mean, just – of everything, from being out of office and now being a private citizen, as opposed to the almost 30 years that you spent as some sort of public official, either in the state Senate, Attorney General, then as governor. I mean,
well, I will say the thing you miss is being able to put your shoulder into something and really move it. I mean, especially when you're governor. I mean, Attorney General is much different than that. You can turn on a dime because every document has your name on it. But as governor, when you felt strongly about something, like when we had that drought that summer, we wanted to drill wells and keep our, you know, we put $20 million of soil and water money in. We did that in 100 days. I mean, so you lose the ability to do that. On the other side, we got to do a lot of very interesting and important things. I'd like to believe that I left that part of my career with my integrity intact and some portion of my sense of humor left. And so the thing that you miss is being able to make a difference. The thing you really enjoy is being able to be a little more creative, being able to read, quite frankly. Mm-hmm. I can close the door and read. I mean, when you're governor, you don't have time to do that. And the reading time that you have, I got up every day and wrote for a half hour every morning and then read for an hour and a half or so, but man, you got to get up at 5 o'clock to do that, yeah. And switching to be able to read, begin factfulness, read The Overstory, which is an interesting book. I mean, to actually read has been fun, and then for Georgianne and I to spend more fun time together has been great.
Well, that's great to hear. So let's kind of launch into our series of topics, and Missouri has been through a really tumultuous 6 months. I think that Governor Parson has definitely calmed things down after the Eric Greitens situation.
Episodes,
whatever. I know that because your law firm was involved in this criminal case, you probably are a little limited of what you can say. And I also know that you don't want to disparage people who have been in your shoes. But
I will tell you, as governor, there's always 6.1 million critics. You don't need to add one more to it as a former
but
governor.
But is there any general observations that you'd be willing to make?
I mean, when you look at these historical shifts, I think that gets important. I think in a time of instant information and gratification, I think people are not digging deeply enough to see the longer-term trends. And I think that the some of the lack of openness stuff is just very real. I mean, because you saw it come before. I mean, my predecessor had some issues on that front a little bit. We tried to – I mean, unfortunately, the thing that's been hard for me getting back to practicing law is sending emails because I just didn't send any as governor.
Yeah.
I mean, I just didn't. And so I spent the first 2 months after church on Sunday afternoons, had a regular appointment with the help desk to learn how to use a computer. I figured if I could run a state, I could do that.
Well, I'm really glad you mentioned that point about openness, because I started my professional career with your predecessor, Governor Matt Blunt. And what you're alluding to is a situation with emails that I'm not going to get into very much. I will say, though, even as a 22-year-old reporter, Governor Blunt always was available to answer questions from me, his staff. Always was available to answer questions for me. Your staff and you personally, after public events, were always usually available to.
I believe
be with
I did
reporter.
Over 1,500 open and availability.
Even if you talk.
And not so much the people that got upset. Even I mean, sometimes the Capitol Press Corps get upset because you just make it available to them instantaneously. But we traveled a lot and got around the state, And so, I mean, after every event I did at every school, at every factory, I took questions.
And here's
that's just the way it went.
And here's the reason I bring that up. Even before January 2018, the former governor often did not make himself available for reporters at all. And we often had questions about what he wanted to do with seismic policy issues, and we had no clue. And I felt like that, and I'm not trying to disparage the former governor here because I know he's gone, but our jobs are to hold powerful people accountable.
Or at least to let the public know, here's what's going on, and here's why they're doing it this way, and here's what they think about it.
So my point is, I would say that I was sort of used to, from the Blunt and Nixon experience, having some accessibility and you being so responsive. And not having that was jarring to me as a reporter.
I think it is a strategy and it's a tactic being used on campaigns and in politics all across the country. It started out saying, what's our message? What's the message box? How do you get everything inside a tight message in a campaign? And now it's evolved into government where and so I just mentioned that I deeply believe in the Fourth Estate and your responsibility, and I think, quite frankly, it helps you govern. And you know you're going to make mistakes. You know you're going to make misstatements if you're in office, and if you can build up enough respect. I remember one time the Post-Dispatch ran a story about the bond issue I was doing or something, and they did something at the mental hospital in Fulton.
Yeah, I remember.
And they took a picture. The picture they used there was a picture of an old door. Okay, it's not relevant for this or any other thing what it is, except that didn't make sense and it was the wrong picture. And I remember I said, get Kurt Erickson on the phone. I mean, tell him, call down there and tell him that's not the right picture. You were there. He was actually there that day. And they did it. You know, you and I have had discussions when I said that's it goes both ways.
Yeah.
You know?
Oh, yeah.
And so I found
times
to be able to, if you get a story that was just didn't have all the facts or it wasn't straight or there was a mistake. I mean, that's the other thing about the press. They work well with you in this state to get things cleaned up.
Yeah.
Because I remember you were it was something in Earth City. It was like a food bank or something. And you had a press avail afterwards. And I asked you, and it was a political question.
Right.
It doesn't matter what it was about. And there's all these people there. And you said, Joe, this is not the proper venue for you to be asking that question. As I'm walking to my car out of the building, grab me and I'll answer it. and I thought, somebody next to me was like,
since we're talking about fun exchanges with Governor Nixon, I actually want to play one that I think has become legendary between the governor and myself. This was involving the now scuttled NFL stadium and a question about the word fiat.
They may be trying to do this to bring you to the table, but isn't that significant enough opposition to give you pause about whether doing it by fiat is workable?
Well, I don't know what this term you're making up as far as doing it by some sort of French car it has got to do with what we're talking about. This is a very open process.
Issuing the bonds without a legislative or popular vote.
The context there isn't important.
It's actually Italian, too. I'm sorry. I apologize.
I just thought that was really funny and just wanted to play that part. But kind of moving forward a little bit, I know you probably have talked with Governor Parson a lot. I'm not asking you to reveal the conversations because they're private. But if you could give some general advice or observations about where things are going right now, that would be I'd be interested to hear that, knowing that you're not going to reveal the exact words that you told
them. Well, first of all, I know the governor relatively well. As folks know, he went to Brazil with me on a trade mission. Mm-hmm. He also was the opposite of me and the architect of the Missouri Compromise after all of the dog issues arose.
Yeah.
And I should note on that one, the story I tell about that is not the substance of the bill that we worked out, but that day was a very interesting day. The bill, in order to get it politically done, the legislature needed to vote to get rid of it, but then we had to fill it up the same day, had to fix the problem the same day. And that was done on a handshake deal with Jay Nixon and Mike Parson. You know, I mean, and it happened the way we said it would. So I'd say that to people that I have found him when he was sheriff in Bolivar and I was attorney general to be a person of his word. I think his wife is substantial, and I like Teresa a lot. I mean, they're good people. I would say if you're looking at being a historian about the future of politics, I'd get out the list of legislators that I took with me while I was governor on foreign trips. And see who those ended up where they ended up. I had pretty good eye for talent, I think. Parsons, governor.
Yeah.
Schmidt is state treasurer. Jason Kander is going to be mayor of Kansas City, it looks like. And you go down on through that list. Todd Richardson had ended up doing pretty well. And we really tried to look for talent. So I say that to people is there's a lot of good people out there that are running for office and are trying to do the best every day.
Well, one of the things, and I'm bringing it up now, I mean, probably during your 8 years as governor, one of the things that attracted national attention for good or bad was the whole Ferguson stuff about 4 years ago. Be 4 years ago in just a few weeks. Yeah. And you came under fire for your the way you dealt with it or the way that some claimed that you didn't deal with it. Okay, but in any event, 4 years now later, looking back, are there things that you think you should have done differently? Are there things that you did that you believe have stood the test of time and shows that you were right with that? Well, I'm just interested in kind of your thoughts now that it's been several years.
First of all, you'd hope generally that those problems would get handled as far as the law enforcement side of it at a local level. Anytime you're bringing the state in because of potential risks, physical risks, damage risks, it's just a difficult situation. So you'd hope to be able to do that. I am very proud that after all of the kinetic part of things were done, that two things jump out. Number one, we didn't walk away. We appointed a commission. We did a lot of things to try to make things better, and I think they're still working. I think that was important, whether it's municipal court reform or some of the education things we did. A lot of effort was spent there. But these are long, hard fights. I mean, I didn't have the ability to read fiction when I was governor because, you know, you lose your place in a book and set it down, and you pick it up a week later, and, you know, you forget where you are. You feel like you feel stupid, so I don't want to do that. At least when I'm governor now, I do it. But the period I focused on to read nonfiction was the 1870s. I thought that was the closest to what we were dealing with, is that post-Civil War, you know, a lot of intensity in Missouri. As you recall, Governor Crittenden ran in 1880 on the platform of ending the Civil War in Missouri. It was an applicable time. So Missouri has always been in the crosshairs. I mean, the easiest thing politically to do would have been to shut up shop and walk away. But I think a lot of people have learned about some of the difficult issues involving race relations, policing, and all of those various things. And I think that conversation continues. And I think Missouri will be in the centerpiece of it for as we continue to hopefully make progress.
The one issue I really wanted to dive deep into is education and the future of education in the St. Louis region. As a resident of St. Louis County now, I know that you probably cared about this particular issue when you were attorney general and dealt with the DSEG case, or when you were dealing with the transfer issue as governor. But I think Ferguson made it very clear that the education system in the St. Louis region was inequitable. If you live in a certain part of St. Louis County or the St. Louis region, your kids can get great education. If you don't happen to have the means to live in a place where there's a good school district, your kids are not going to get as good of an education. This also goes for special education as well, an issue that I know full well. Has that been your observation too over the years, that depending on where you live is kind of where, what type of education you're going to get in the St. Louis region?
I think there are differences between the schools, differences in the opportunities, of especially some of the curriculum opportunities in some of the schools. But I think oftentimes they reflect the communities and the challenges that are in those very communities. I think sometimes we pass on to public education challenges, economic challenges, racial challenges, all that sort of stuff. And then they show up and they're at kindergarten and, all right, it's the state's problem to solve. And then if after 12 years everything isn't perfect, we end up blaming them. And that's why I've been such a strong supporter of making sure that community schools are engaged and that people get buy-in to improve the schools and improve the opportunity. I'd also like to say that I think that we have made significant progress. You look at the work done by Riverview Gardens. You look at the work done by the Normandy School Cooperative. I mean, when you get in there and work, you can make things better. But inequality of education, inequality of opportunity is something that I think tracks with other socioeconomic, other business, other issues as well.
I want to play a clip now from St. Charles County Executive Steve Ellman, who I think was a state legislator when you were attorney
well,
general.
Well, actually, they're friends.
Yeah. I think you're pretty good friends. And I say this not to suck up to him, but he probably is one of the more thoughtful politicians, local politicians in the St. Louis region, one with institutional memory that a lot of people don't have. And He made this observation about how St. Charles deals with their schools compared to St. Louis County, and then I want to use it as a jumping off point for discussions.
Instead of 25 school districts like St. Louis County, we have five, okay? We have, in each of those school districts, we have some poor kids. And you can look at the free and reduced lunch. It varies from 20 to 40%, okay, depending on which district you're looking at. But, you know, the nationwide average is 50%. So, yes, we have some schools that might have more than 40%. But that's a neighborhood problem. It's not a district-wide problem, okay? So we have poor kids. They have disproportionately more problems in school and need more attention and more resources. But as long as they're spread out to all the districts and all the schools, you can provide that. The problem is when you have situations like Normandy, where, you know, the number of poor people in that district just got to the point where it overwhelmed the district's resources.
That seems like a pretty astute observation. Obviously, hindsight is 20/20, and Elman had the opportunity to learn from St. Louis County's mistakes, and also the demographics are wildly different between the two places. But is he right? Does St. Louis County have too many school districts, and are there situations where there are too many poor
people
there?
I think there's way too much government in the St. Louis region.
Okay.
I mean, we got too many cities, we got too many fire districts, water districts, school districts, the whole thing. I mean, is and people don't even know where the lines are. They don't know what their districts are. Maybe for their kids for school they do. Yeah. And I think that's something that St. Louis is going to have to get beyond. I don't know, you know, I'm not here laying out a 10-point plan to do it, but there's just way too much governmental structure around every decision that's made in this region.
Yeah. Well, from your years as governor, did you notice, I mean, because you're from Jefferson County originally, whether or not that impeded the St. Louis area trying to lobby or get certain things to the General Assembly because of that? Or is it something that everybody takes into account because of that?
I don't think that the – I mean, speaking in a broader sense of history, I mean, I'm a unique historical figure in the situation is that, you know, we had desegregation cases in both the St. Louis and Kansas City districts that I was in charge of, went all the way to the Supreme Court, negotiated the end of those, and had not one but two cases saying that the methods with which we funded K through 12 education was unconstitutional. 10 days after I was sworn in as Attorney General, the trial court ruled in that original case saying that the way we were passing out money was unconstitutional. So literally within 2 weeks of being Attorney General, every single public school kid in the state was involved in litigation that I was responsible for. So you couple then move forward to being governor. And yeah, I think I've seen some of the challenges that are out there, and they're significant. And the other thing, I just have to say it here. We can't forget that money is important. I mean, we all know how much the Cardinals. I mean, my gosh, they're paying this Cecil guy $15 million a year, and we're paying the right fielder to strike out $82 million. I mean, but yet if you talk about schools or public resources, people get all up in arms. And I think that the continuing effort by the policymakers in Jeff City, i.e. the legislature, to continue to cut taxes is making it extremely difficult to have the resources to compete. It's not free. And if you continue to see the drop of teacher salaries relative to other professions, if you continue to see the lack of support in those areas, I mean, my golly, we're in a year. I know, Jason, I'm jumping out of K through 12 into higher ed. But we're in a year in which a number of people in higher education are very happy to have their zero increase.
Yeah.
Well, that's in a year in which we had 3.8% unemployment. Okay. That's a good year. Almost $400 million of additional tax revenue came into the state of Missouri this year, and they were happy with zero of it. I mean, I think people involved in education are going to have to get strong too. The money matters in these situations. Well, it really does.
Well, I mean, okay, during especially your second term, I mean, you vetoed one tax cut, and that was sustained. But then you got overridden a couple years later, and now that one's just starting to really hit. I mean,
and I think they just passed another bill that drops it from like all the way to five.
But I mean, as you're looking at that, at the same time that, like you're saying, that you've got rural hospitals that have been closing, not because of lack of money, but because there was no Medicaid expansion.
That's right on Medicaid expansion. Each one of these hospitals that have been closing were ones that were on the watch list that I talked specifically to people about, that I said if we don't do something, they're going to be in trouble. The one in Kennett, obviously, was the most recent one. The Herman situation, in which they got bought, and they have just an outpatient place there compared to what they had before. I mean, sending all our tax dollars to D.C. and having a political fight about letting them be spent in other states is not good policy. Okay, it's just not.
So I guess I kind of meshed two things there. But when you look back, I mean, because I would think that would be something that you were disappointed in, that A, you weren't able to persuade the General Assembly to go to Medicaid expansion, and instead they did these tax cuts that you thought were ill-advised.
I think, Joe, you missed one of the, okay. the two. I mean, we had two significant big bills that I was successful on in that sense. And once again, I cut taxes. I thought you should cut taxes in the correct way. We got rid of the franchise tax by right. phasing it out. I thought it was a double taxation. Because of political pressure, we knew we were going to get rid of the tax on military retirees. So we phased that out. We did them in responsible ways that gave us an opportunity to continue to pay the bills and predict the future. The first one of those was $253, $1 billion tax cut. We were able to flip 18 votes and hold that veto. The second was that Friday Favors. They came back the next year. That was another $780 million in cuts, including a bunch of sales tax things that would have affected cities and ongoing projects. So, I mean, almost $2 billion wouldn't be in the general revenue fund every year. The one I got overridden on was 509, lost yes. by one vote. And my sense is a lot of the folks in the education community just got tired of fighting. Mm.
So, I mean, you're not governor now, but, I mean, when you're looking and watching this, do you think that there's going to be a movement to change any of that, or do you think this is a done deal? That
Missouri's a low-tax state. I mean, but you have to manage it in a way that, I mean, we have over 5,000 fewer state employees from the beginning of my term to the end. You have got to get tech adoption, you've got to get things down. I mean, we're at 36,000, they said, on inmates now. I mean, yeah. and the number of employees involved in there. When I left as governor, you were spending about $700 million a year in general revenue on corrections and about $125 million on community colleges. That's not the right mix.
So that kind of gets me into the question about, Governor Parson and the legislature. So it's a much different situation than you were in. You were in a situation where, at best, when you entered office, you had a Republican legislature, but not super majorities, and also leaders that you worked well with, like Charlie Shields and Ron Richard, to probably some of the lesser fun situations where you had lots of Republicans and leaders that you probably didn't care for that much. So this is a clip from when Mike Parson was sworn into office, and I got the honor to ask him what he would do differently than his predecessor, because former Governor Greitens had a bad relationship with the legislature as a former—
Worse than you had.
I would argue worse than yours in many respects. And I wanted to see what Governor Parson wanted to do differently.
There's many, many common grounds for the state of Missouri, such as infrastructure, such as workforce development. There's many things like that we come together. And my purpose for being the governor will be to try to bring people together, to try to move the state of Missouri forward.
So that sounds really nice, but I think your experience that you probably saw as governor is there has to be instances where the executive branch says no to the legislature, because if you just rubber stamp everything, you could be potentially passing bills that aren't written correctly. They could be policies that you philosophically disagree with. I could see Governor Parson being very successful in terms of enacting legislation, but given your experience, what would you tell him about being a bulwark against a legislature that wants to exert its power?
Well, he has graduated from being a legislator, and he's chief executive of the state, and laying out a vision for the future of the state is something I think he's fully competent, capable of doing. And I think by the time he gets ready for the beginning of next year in the state of the state, you're going to see somebody that says where he feels the state should go. I think that you all in the fourth estate and I respect the legislature. Believe me, I served in it. I respect them. I understand. Their job is to write laws. Not investigate things, not I mean, sometimes they have to, obviously, but I think that you don't find generally great creative ideas on how to run government from legislators. It's just not their position. they think of the budget as expending money, and executives think about it as moving the needle on issues. So I'm kind of getting far afield here, but I had 276 vetoes that I won on, and I've sustained. That's a record. And I feel very good about those when you look at them in the sense of
history. Although there was a number of record overwrites too, right?
Well, they started running up numbers, tried to run up some numbers on some silly stuff. But I think that, trying to tell Columbia they couldn't give a people a choice between paper and plastic or something. It's not gonna bring down the democracy on a.
I'm not so sure about that. Columbia is just out of control right now. But continue.
Hell, I used to say the People's Republic of Boone up there. It's fine. But the point is, you couldn't fight every battle. But other than 509, I was. You look at the ones we were successful on; they were pretty significant in a lot of ways.
So I do,
but I don't think about my. I do not think of my legacy as how many bills I vetoed or what I stopped.
Okay. Well, okay.
So that's the point. Is as a governor, you're trying to move things forward. When you look at when I graduated as governor, we had a 36% increase in the number of folks that graduated from our public colleges with 4-year degrees. We had a 44% increase in my time as governor on people that got the 2-year scholarships for the A+.
Right.
But when you can go and talk to a company and say, invest in Missouri, look, we've had an increase of 36% in 4 years and 44%. When you look at a state writ large, things like that, the rebuilding the mental hospital in Fulton, it never would have been done if we didn't put that at Front Street and make it something important. Built in 1851. That's going to be a tremendous facility for everybody when it opens in 19.
And I actually, one of the things that Governor Parson was also involved, I think, was bonding for higher education facilities, if I'm not mistaken, which I think is going to be pretty significant. Maybe they'll name a building after him or yourself.
Well, we were all involved in that, and Mike was a good leader during that process. But I will say that one of the reasons that process was successful was the first year the legislature wanted to do it, and they could only clear one project through and put it in the appropriation bill also. And the $200 million was the number we were going to use. So during that summer, between when the session ended and when it started again, we met with every board and every president, and we got them to give us their priorities, and we put together an exact list based on their percentage of state funding, and all of those projects were the ones that were passed. So I'm very proud of the fact that we didn't have politics involved in that. That was something that we worked with the colleges and the chancellors and the presidents to choose what was important, and that's the exact list that passed.
Whoa. Politics involved with higher education facilities?
Oh, Jason.
Are you talking about Mohila, Governor? Okay. Continue.
Okay, now we're I do want to segue a little bit into environmental.
He's the youngest old guy in the whole in the whole press corps,
Do you know how many hours I had to spend listening to filibuster about Mohila? It took away like 3 or 4 days of my life. I'm not going to forget that. Yeah. But continue, Joe.
Okay. The environment.
With Wes Schumacher's Mostila.
Mostila.
Oh, yeah, I remember that.
Yes.
Because back when you first ran, for the U.S. Senate, way back in the 80s, environment was one of your issues.
Absolutely.
And then near the end of your second term as governor, there was the whole thing with the parks and some additional parks created. And then your successor, Greitens, was trying to get rid of some of those parks because he thought that it had been sort of.
Because people only voted 81% for a parks tax the same day they voted 58% for Donald Trump. People in Missouri like parks. Okay.
So,
they do.
So,
just ask Charlie Dooley about that.
Okay.
But continue.
Okay, yeah. So, but my point is just kind of what is your thoughts? As far as some of these parks that may be sold or not developed, the ones that you were trying to put in at the end?
Those are two wildly
that?
Different terms. First of all, they're not going to be sold.
Okay.
We're not going to sell park land. They've already said they're not going to. And when they have these meetings and everybody shows up, hundreds if not thousands of people show up and say don't do that. And plus, without going into excruciating detail, it would be very difficult to do that legally based on the way that the land was acquired.
Spoken like a lawyer. Go ahead.
Well, a significant portion of it came from the Asarco settlement that I had to go when I was attorney general send the assistant down to San Antonio to work through that bankruptcy to get those funds. Money was split in half to buy land, half to clean up things. And it's, we're co-trustees with the Secretary of Interior, who I flew to D.C. twice, met with Sally Jewell twice. I mean, so there's a number of things. There are people like parks that are important. I'm very proud of the work we did. Added to almost 16,000 acres. And we have less debt than when I came in as governor. So it's not like we're wasting money or borrowing money.
Oh, no, I'm not saying that. It's just, it's interesting. Nobody talks about parks in Jeff City now. And when you were governor, they did.
And you know, I think as someone who just visited state parks last summer in the Lesterville area, they're huge tourist attractions, and they're probably big economic drivers for a lot of these communities that have a lot of poverty. Like Iron County has a couple of these parks that bring people from all over the state, and I've driven through Iron County and Reynolds County. They have immense issues with poverty, and without those parks, it would probably be destitution everywhere.
It's really, really important in some of those regions, because you put parks in rural areas generally. Echo Bluff, I mean, when last time I was down there, they were talking about how much more sales tax they had in the county budget this year than they had the year before on that project. You know, real proud of that. So I think that not only parks, but conservation. Was glad to see the Supreme Court decision a couple of weeks ago saying that, amazingly enough, deer are not livestock. You know, that's I was also glad to win that veto. When they tried to do that through the legislative process.
Yeah, I covered that debate.
And like I say, the other part for me, if I was going to get on offense about parks, is to finish the Rock Island Line piece. Mm-hmm. And what I was saying, Joe, when I rudely interrupted you, was there is when you get, so let's say we get the Rock Island Line finished, you know, get the property into the rail banking system. You don't have to develop it that day. Okay, right. It's public land. It can be developed. If it's 20 years until there's another governor, another legislature that really cares about this stuff, fine. The land will be there, and it can be developed then. Getting it safe and in a place that it can be developed. I'll tell you, that as pretty a tract of land as we ever got is that tract down on the 11 Point River, that 5,000 acres down there. That's going to be unbelievable. I mean, that's where the Beatles came when they were taking a summer trip one time.
Yeah, and the reason I was looking at my phone was I think I saw something on Twitter, of all places, where Governor Parson said something about that project. I think he's more enthused about it than his predecessor. Have you heard anything about that on that front or not?
I mean,
not really.
Governor's always been a supporter of parks, and both as a state senator, a state representative, and as lieutenant governor, sits on a tourism commission. He understands those numbers you're talking about, and it's not by accident that we finally hit our 20 million number that we were aiming to as far as visitors in our state parks the same year we set a record for tourism as far as spend in Missouri. They're intertwined, and the outdoor economy is extremely important to the Show Me State.
Well, so okay. Then this perfect segue to go the shift into the other topic, sports.
Oh my!
Because I mean, you know, because while the St. Louis area has its share of parks, many of them are county owned or city owned or whatever. But I know that you had some strong views as far as the battle over the soccer stadium,
The football stadium,
and the football stadium, and what. Is or is not happening with Ballpark Village. I'm just interested in your take on all that, especially now that you live here.
I get up Saturday morning, I open the Post Dispatch, and there's yet another letter from Fred Lindecki on that. Fred's a great guy. I remember all the years he sat there and we worked together. I mean, when he was in the Senate and I worked together, he was.
Yeah, Fred was my predecessor. Yeah. He covered politics at the Post Dispatch back in the 80s, early 90s.
But, I mean, Georgiana and I were at the Muni on Sunday evening. We have bought season tickets this year. That's a public facility. The last 15 rows are free. We're watching a production of Annie in which the lead role was played by a young woman whose mother had the lead role in the original Annie on Broadway. Okay? The week before that, we watched Jersey Boys.
Which was spectacular,
unbelievable.
Folks.
And did you see who was all – they took – what they got is cast members from around the country of various – Jersey Boys over the years and picked the best ones and did that.
Yeah, because it was the first regional production of Jersey Boys outside of Broadway or national tours.
And driving home, we drove by the Dwight Davis Tennis Center, which has been pretty good, Dwight Davis and the Davis Cup. The bottom line is, all of the dollars that have been spent appropriately in Forest Park Forever, public-private partnership, doing what it's doing in Forest Park. I mean, St. Louis... I mean, I think there are still potentially some avenues on soccer, but that may go down as one of the larger mistakes. And I think it didn't pass for two or three reasons.
Yeah, explain about this.
Well, I mean, the county should have been playing.
Yeah, and I was going to mention that. And this seems to get glossed over a lot about in the discussion. The handlers of that stadium did not even apparently talk constructively with Stenger at all. That's not true?
That is definitely not true.
Well, explain. Because Stenger
there's a campaign going on right now. Yeah. I'm not going to jump in the middle of a campaign, but I will tell you, I will look you straight in the eye and say that is not true.
Oh, okay. Well,
okay.
The point is they weren't involved, and then city voters thought that they were bearing the entire brunt of this when the county, hypothetically, I'm being very hypothetical here. If they passed a half-cent sales tax and kept it for 2 years, they could have paid for the entire public outlay for that stadium in 2 years. So my point is, like, the county could have been involved and helped defray the city's costs, but, you know, you mentioned
it's like asking Michael Schilt whether he should have kept in the rookie Ponce de Leon last night to stay on the no-hitter.
Yeah, exactly.
Things have been different. You don't get a choice to replay the games.
Fair enough.
And so these regional issues are huge, and soccer, you know, 71,000 people in Atlanta on their brand new team watched a game the same day as a big game in the World Cup. Soccer is the world sport. It has an unbelievable history in St. Louis. And yes, that wasn't perfect. Quite frankly, the changes that they made in the soccer thing before that were a little bit troublesome too, because without going into excruciating detail, the deal we'd put out for that property was much better for taxpayers than the one that eventually with the changes happened. But
yes.
Bottom line is that I grow really tired of people saying, we shouldn't do that. We should do something else. And then they don't do something else. I mean, maybe buy trash trucks would have been a good thing with it. But you got a city that's already got a $1.1 billion budget that's bigger than most cities its size. So the bottom line is that soccer, I hope there's some way to salvage that. As far as NFL, I don't want to speak on that because there's a lawsuit and I may be a witness and all that sort of stuff. But
you might be a witness?
I was around things.
Well, yeah. How else do you think I won a Missouri Broadcasting Award for Best Sports Story? It's because I was around you all the time during that situation. Okay. But continue.
But go ahead.
But the point is, whether we like it or not, and I tend to kind of like it, people talk about sports. They talk about things, and cities are identified with that, and the joy that comes of a collective. I mean, we got the Cardinals here. We got the best baseball organization in the world here. Okay. And we don't have a football team. Soccer would seem to fit. Or a G League team for the NBA would be good to get down here pretty soon.
Hey, listen, if an NBA team—
Can we keep the Blues? Do you think we'll be able to keep the Blues?
Yeah, you got a local ownership group, and they're investing a lot. I think that's the kind of
local ownership. Why hasn't there been a serious push to get the NBA in St. Louis? I mean, I'm a huge NBA fan because I'm from the Chicagoland area, and I would probably buy season tickets if they were in St. Louis, but I've just heard— various reasons why that's never came to be. Do you have any theories about that?
I've been involved in three efforts.
Yeah.
One of which was dealt with the Vancouver team.
Mm-hmm.
Another were in potentially New Orleans and then Memphis team. Those got going but didn't really get going in the way that it takes. And then I came up with an idea. And that idea was to do like the Green Bay Packers used to play some games in Milwaukee and some games in Green Bay.
Yeah.
So I had to be in New York anyway, so I made an appointment with David Stern, the NBA commissioner at the time, and I said, I got an idea. We'll get an NBA team for Missouri, and we'll share some games in St. Louis and some games in Kansas City, because the NBA has a very complicated formula about what the dollars spend are in a market.
Mm-hmm.
That may have changed with the Rams not being here, and we may be higher on their list than we were. But at the time, we weren't high enough with sport dollar spend in this region for what they were wanting. So I said, Mr. Commissioner, how about we do that? And he looked at me and said, Governor, no one in the world knows more about basketball and money than me, meaning him, the commissioner, he said. And we're not going to do that. And I can either take the hour that we've got set aside to explain to you in painstaking detail why we're not going to do that, or we can talk about something else. And I decided to talk about something else.
That's a shame.
I've always wanted – I mean, I think that the NBA is growing. The other trouble you got with NBA teams is they're all worth $1 billion now.
Yeah, they are.
I mean, and $1 billion is a different – that's a big – That's a big spend.
Yeah.
I mean,
yes.
It takes the Coles to to keep
without getting
the
into
bucks going.
Without understanding that you can't talk a lot about the mechanics of the Rams situation. Do you feel that St. Louis lost luster by not having an NFL team? Because that was the argument that you were making. A lot of other people were too.
I think there were three really good arguments. I think getting to the riverfront. I stood down there and said, if we don't do this, it's going to look exactly the same a year from now, 2 years from now, 5 years from now.
You mean as far as building a new...
Putting it there. That site for St. Louis, think about coming across the Stan Musial Bridge and looking at a brand new stadium and all of the development around it, or you can look at what's there now, which is extremely difficult area for the
it
front
is.
Porch
and I've literally
yeah.
stood there and recorded something, and it is not easy at all.
No,
but continue.
So there was that. There was just the image part of was important. I think economically, clearly having an NFL team gives you not only profile, but a lot of spend. There's just a whole lot of spend involved with the NFL. And the third one, I told people, whether it is the Rams or somebody else, if you're governor, you don't want to lose any businesses.
No, it's understandable.
You fight for them all. If somebody says they're going to come and take a business from your state, you go fight. And I was successful at fighting. We kept Harley Davidson in Kansas City. We built a new Ford plant. We built a new Ford plant out here that was on the cutting room floor. Mm-hmm. I think there was a lot of reasons, but yes, it puts the focus on your city. It puts the international notice, which is important.
Is there anything you want to say about why Stan Kroenke decided to go ahead and move the team, no matter what?
With litigation out there, I'm not going to. I just don't think it's right for me to talk at this particular time. We'll come back in a couple of years after all that's over, and
we'll spend a whole show talking about Stan Kroenke and his billions of dollars. In the final few minutes that we have, the last time we had you on, we kind of reflected on kind of your political accomplishments. The fact that you, when you ran for governor twice, you won by overwhelming margins and won places.
And you had decent coattails.
You won lots of rural areas. We kind of went into excruciating detail about the legislature changing. Things are obviously going to change with the election. You know, Donald Trump's popularity is going to have a big impact. But do you think that a Democrat can replicate what you did in 2008, 2012 and win a lot of rural Missouri? Or do you think that strategy is over?
They have to adopt a different
Is rural Missouri just too far gone for Democrats? Well,
I don't think so. I won there a lot, and I think the people haven't changed that much. You got to go listen to them and be with them and share their values and understand the complexity of the state. No, I think people, and you've seen Senator McCaskill and her campaigns focus a tremendous amount of attention here on getting out in those areas. I think you got to go talk to people. I think every voter, you got to have a message for everybody, and I always believe that if I had a chance to spend 5 minutes with somebody, I had a really good chance to get their vote.
Yeah, and I keep mentioning wherever they were from, I keep mentioning the rural parts, and I know that Democrats don't necessarily have to win those areas, but they have to at least compete now, because we saw with the Kander race, for example, that he won St. Louis County, Jackson County, a couple other ones, and didn't win Jefferson County, didn't win Lincoln County, didn't win Buchanan County, and then lost the rural areas by a lot. If he would have won the rural areas by a little bit more or won some of those collar counties, including Jefferson County, I think he would have beaten Roy Blunt. But that's why you have to take all this into play.
So
well, it was something I worked on, not just for the campaign. I mean, I always worked on it. I got out, and I was in these areas. I'm real proud of some counties that we won. I mean, I won 56 counties. I flipped 56 counties in 08 from where they were in 04.
Are there particular issues that you think are the most persuasive ones to deal with statewide and even in rural Missouri? I mean, are there things that you think that maybe that the Democrats are doing that are smart because you think that's going to appeal and that it is a key issue? Or are there things that they're not talking enough about? Now that you've had time to kind of
step back. Lot of news has gone national. A lot of analysis has gone national. And in that sense.
And is that a mistake?
Well, I think that some people let that wind blow in the face with them and don't get out and come into it. I mean, for example, I mean, there's some people who believe the Democratic Party is a party of entitlement, the Republican Party is a party of work. I'm not one of those people that believes that, but I think the Democrats need to talk about work and need to talk about the value of work. Public education is something that I think the Democratic Party supports, and I think you talk about the issues you talk about in St. Louis County are relevant here for your DMA here, but really, when you talk about public education, you got a lot of small schools and a lot of communities all over the state that you don't want to make people ride on buses for 4 or 5 hours. I think there's a whole list of issues.
What about health care?
I mean, health care is one that we had a lot of support in the rural areas. Once it got I remember when Romney was debating Obama in the first debate, and he said something about health care. He looked at and he said, Obamacare. And then he looked, being a respectful guy that he is, he looked at the president and said, is it okay if I call it that? And Obama said, yes. And much like the fact that at the end of the press conference that the president had before the summer recess when all heck broke loose, his last question, he should have let go. That was about the professor in Boston that ended up having the beer summit and all stuff. That was that summer that things went off the rail on health care. Mm-hmm. I think there's a great message on health care. I think it's very real. People understand health care, and the people that learn how to frame that issue correctly are going to succeed politically.
And this is something I brought up with a couple other people. At this point in the election cycle, when there wasn't a Democratic incumbent, there was already somebody running for governor. I think you basically began your first gubernatorial campaign in earnest 2005, 2006. Chris Koster, 2013, 2014. Doesn't seem to be happening now with Democrats. I think some people are looking to see what happens to Nicole Galloway, the person that you appointed to the office.
She's doing a great job,
Is she somebody that you think could be a good gubernatorial nominee in a couple of years? Because I know that seems like a far away because you got to get through this election cycle, but to raise the amount of money and to build the organization to run for governor, you kind of have to start not just now, but like a year ago. So like, who are you seeing who could possibly be a good person for your party right now?
I mean, there's a lot of the Democratic Party is in an internal kind of tussle about, especially nationally, about how progressive. And I'm dealing with some issues nationally, trying to make sure that the heartland is not left out of the equation of the discussions. In 2020.
So, are you talking to people on the DNC and stuff? Is that what you're doing?
I generally don't talk to the DNC. I talk to principals. We have a lot of. I mean, when I was sworn in as governor. In January 2009, you had Democrat governors in Ohio, Michigan, Wisconsin, Illinois, Tennessee, Kentucky, Arkansas, Oklahoma, Kansas, and Iowa. When I left 8 years later, there wasn't a single one. I was the last one.
Even in Illinois?
So the point about that is that people shouldn't – sure, there's going to be comebacks. Sure, there's going to be things. Hard work matters. Connecting with the issues matters. I think as you get to the rural parts of the state of Missouri, people make a mistake of just focusing in on corn prices or bean prices, which are important to the economy out there. But it's really small towns is what's out there. And the schools and the churches and the other things that they're proud of. And the outdoor things is huge. I mean, I think there's a path – I don't think I'm that unique. I think it can be done. If I can do it, a lot of people with talent.
But you're not going to say who.
But as far as the next cycle, I think you got to get through 18. I think this is a turbulent time. This cat in the White House is a whole different species
who
of communicator.
Who is coming to the St. Louis region on, Thursday, but I think we're going to be posting this well afterwards. Any final thoughts you want to say before we let you go back into the private sector?
The press cannot give up. you guys got to keep going.
That bother you as far as the discussion on fake news or the fact? I mean, you know, the president, as we're taping this, the president's on the other side of the state today. I mean, you've served with Republican presidents and with Democratic presidents. Of course, now you're in private practice, but I'm just curious, speaking in general, are there things that bother you as far as trends? National trends?
I try to – what my mind thought on this, Joe, is I try not to worry about the people who get elected. I try to worry about the people that vote for them. So I think that you got to talk about what happened to get it here and what can you do to communicate to people. Because there's this economy leaves a whole bunch of people out all over the place.
Yeah.
And the folks that can get into a positive message on that as opposed to a demagogic message attacking people there are going to be the ones that succeed long run.
We'll leave it at that, and we'll bring you back in 2 years so you can talk about NFL football a little bit more. I just want to sincerely thank you for coming today. Some of our best podcasts that we've done have been with former governors. We had a great one with Bob Holden and Kit Bond a few years ago, and even though we had you on right before you left and you talked about your legacy, I feel like talking to former governors after they're out of office is really valuable to our listeners and for posterity. So I really want to thank you for coming today.
Thank you. Thanks for having me.
For all of our stories, stlpublicradio.org. Follow me on Twitter at Jay Rosenbaum. Follow Joe on Twitter at
Jay Manis. That's J-M-A-N-N-I-E-S.
You're still at Gov Jay Nixon, and I'm guessing that you actually write your own tweets now because the voice is just screaming Jay Nixon right there, right?
I'm not as frequent, but I try to be impactful when I do.
Well, follow him. He is very fun to watch when he tweets. Until next time, so long.
Gateway brings you the day's news from the St. Louis region and across Missouri. It also includes stories from the Illinois side of the river and our Metro East reporter, Will Bauer.
In Alton, in Belleville, in East St. Louis, in Edwardsville, in Cahokia Heights, at Scott Air Force Base, I'm Will Bauer, St. Louis Public Radio.
Listen to reports from Will and all of our journalists weekdays on the Gateway, on the STLPR app, and wherever you get podcasts.